Projects, I represent your challenge, my nigga. How you? The fuck lips now, the gun power. Be going down, diggy, diggy down, diggy down.
While the planets and the stars and the moons collapse, When I raise my trigger finger, all y'all niggas hit the deck. Cause ain't no need for that. Hustlers and hardcore. Roar to the floor, roar like reservoir doors. The green eyed bandit can't stand it. With more booty and loose than that, you can't stand it. Plus, the Bombazi got me wild.
Fucking with us.
It's a straight suicide.
3-9-8-7-6-5-4-3-2 murder, one lyric at your door. The cow bringing to that ass roar. Breaking all the rules like glass jaws. Nigga, y'all got to get mine to get yours. Fucker, we don't need no rap tour. I'd rather kick the facts and catch you with the rap chore. More than you bargained for. The cow that stays open like an all-night store. For real, like you should ill, like a piece of blue steel. Pointed at your temple with the intent to kill. And then your existence. M.E.T. ain't no use for resistance. H-O-D.
I'll be the ultimate rush to any nigga on dust. The Egyptian must used to have me format sluts. I ship like a clutch with the ruck. Examine my nuts, I don't stop till I get enough. Your shit broke down like your flare. Just the dark side tears you into Hollywood squares. 6 million ways to die, so I chose. Made it 6 million and run with your eyes closed. The blindfold cold so you can feel the rap. And shatter the glass in second half of your funky ass. And you're my man. Bitches used to play me, now they can't forget me now. They give me nine, I rock the spot, check clock. If the offer licking up and hip hop. Fuck the billboard, I'm a bullet on my block. How you know when you pay for your billboard spot?
Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane.
It's the funk, knock the spot, smoking Buddha on the train. So how did I get kissed the sky?
How sick.
So sick that you can suck my dick. Look up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane.
Recognize Johnny, please, ain't a damn thing changed.
How high?
So sick that you can suck one dick. So my man, read a ruckus, come home. It ain't really on till the ruckus get home. Up on my phone, now I'm on to the red zone. We don't need your dirt, we got our fucking own. Check it, I reach havoc with my hectic. Bring the pain, lyrics, screaming for the antiseptic. Move it on your left, kick, and I'm left. I'm a fucking dome piece, plus I got no love from the beast. Hailing from the Big East Coast, where niggas pack toast. Home of the drug kingpin.
Hey, Roy, you the rude boy on the block. You tried to stop the bum rush, you will get fucked.
I'm on the line with a racist. My style was born in the Lizzie staircases. Dickens, F a rap critic. He talk about it while I live it. And Fred got the blunt, I'm the second one there.
Look up in the, I got the verb nouns and glocks in ya. Into the center, lyrics bang like Vicar. Shane Rabbit, I bring habit with an AK matic. Rolling blunts and all day habit. I get it all like Smith and West. Who clicks the best? Folks take a sip and test. Who splits your best? The folk phenomenon. I'm bombing you like Lebanon. No canals at Panama, just all stamina. Style's not to be fucked with or played with. Fuck them pretty hoes, I love those Section 8 bit. Just hitting snitches, twisting wigs with that radical mathematical type scriptures. I dig up in your planets like Digger. Boo, scared you. Blew you to smither, freeze. Fuck the Marines, I got machines that like to spit and read bad magazines. I play more heads than continental. Wreck your fine times like U.S. Air off an instrumental. Look, I'm not a halfway crook with bad looks, but I make murder your case like your name is Cal Brooks. I break some more proper. Ask Biggie Smalls who shot ya. Get doctor with the 12-gauge Mossberg. Look, I got the tools they wrinkle to make your mind tickle.
Yo,
for the nine nickel.
Yo, Brad, your
wrong ass pussy ass.
Yeah, when everyone you thought you knew deserts your fight, I'll go with you. You're facing down a dark hall. I'll grab my light and go with you. I'll 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 go with you. Surrounded air. Up against the wall, I'll shred them all and go with you. When choices end, you must defend. I'll grab my bat and go with you. I'll go with you. I'll go with you. I'll go with you. Yeah.
Stay with me.
Impossible or easy, but I'll never leave my block, my need me.
hip-hop lock. Everybody business ain't too great. What's going on in this house? Staying here comprehending. Blah, blah. You had to have that understanding. Cause if you told Miss Maddie, she went and told Gladys. If it was your mama got it, it was all on the wire. And when the word got back, they said, yo, so far. Well, blah, blah, we got some non-fed shell shock. When the right got right, now they can help. Blah, blah. It's like the world don't exist. We say goodbye to this small little section we living in. Blah, blah. I wouldn't trade it for the world, cause I love these little boys and girls on the grave. Blah, blah. Blah, blah. Everything is everything, but it's easy. Blah, blah. Probably got it all, homie, but easy. Blah, blah. Everything is everything, but she's me, blah, blah. We probably done it all, homie, believe me, blah, blah. We made the impossible, believe me, but she's me. I'll never leave my blood, but believe me.
What's up, YouTube? It's Artisan MC. It's Sunday, and as you can see, the shop is open. It's a little special day today that this is only the second time I've actually broadcast live from the shop. So I'm covering for Ford today. He's taking care of some family business. So shout out to Ford and the fam. And that means you got me here. And I still got a show to do. That means it has to get done here. So if you saw the earlier show, there was a lot of technical difficulties and I was not satisfied with that shit at all. So I went ahead and went back and recorded a new show. It's just what it is. So by the time you see this, maybe it'll be a bit more polished, but I'll cut in the panel conversation that I had on the rest of the show in with this, the good parts, and try to put this all out as one video. I just wasn't satisfied with how the shit was working. There was too many technical difficulties right up front. So fuck it. Do it over. It's my show. I can do what I want. So today, a lot of geek stuff. This is all geek stuff. This week is pretty much a straight geeked up panel conversation and a geeked up week because of one event only, primarily, and that's DC fandom. Now, for everybody who doesn't know, DC fandom is an event that was supposed to be happening on the DC Universe platform. But since AT&T bought that Warner DC stuff and are doing away with the DC Universe app, they decided to make this all virtual. It's a virtual comic convention, basically, is what they're doing, or a trade show for DC merch, right? So before we get all into that, hit the like button on your way in, support the stream. Cash App information should be there, and it's not there right now. So we will do this, and we'll do this. There you go. That makes it a little better. Now you can see exactly what we're talking about, and I can bring this camera down a little bit so you can actually see me. So I can sit down since I've been standing up all day. So support the stream if you feel so inclined and hit the like button on your way in. So, geek shit. There was some other geek stuff that happened this week as well with Star Wars, and I think I'll wait till next week to do all the Star Wars stuff because it's a lot and some really interesting stuff on top of that. And I want to give it its own due attention. So next week, 1.27, look for the Star Wars stuff to come up. Project Power. I do have a review for Project Power, and I was trying to get out there and be first, but I saw that Dr. Tiasan did a review before I did, and I didn't watch it yet. I didn't watch his review yet. I watched the show, and I was like, God dang it. And then right when I was going to record the review, I saw Angry Man do his review of it as well. It's like, shit. So it kind of messed up my review of what I was going to do because I hadn't had it recorded already. So I didn't want what they said to influence the way I went into the review, because I have to watch the review fresh with fresh eyes in my own voice and record it and get it recorded and done. So when I start listening to other people's takes on it, I'm not having that inform my opinion of what I saw, because then it's more like an answer rather than my review and my reaction of what it is that I saw. At the time, I couldn't extricate the two. So they brought up some things that made me want to go back and look at it and see if that was there as heavy as was said. And so I held off. I held to my 1 week moratorium on reviewing geek stuff and went back and just held off on it. And I was too busy at work, so I didn't even record the review yet. I don't even have it now. So it'll come, but for the most part, I will tell you, was the Project Power show as good as Angry Man was saying it was being hyped up on Facebook? No, was it? That was, at best, it's a Sunday bingeable. And understand, it's only one episode of it, and a binge means that you're doing more than one thing. But if you were just going to watch it on a Sunday and you wanted to get your fix of superhero, or not even superhero, but people with powers kind of situation, you can get off on that. All right. You can watch that and enjoy it. Jason Gordon-Levitt is not a bad actor. Jamie Foxx is not a bad actor. I even liked the girl they had playing the character in here. She was pretty decent. It's some good actors in this show, but at best, it's just a Sunday movie. It's just something you watch on a Sunday to scratch that itch. You watch it, you get in, you get the hell out, and it's all done. You know, leave the money on the nightstand and call it a day. So it's not like, oh my God, Jamie Foxx is back and whatever. Like, look, Jamie Foxx's last superhero role was fucking Electro in Amazing Spider-Man. And that was a knockoff of Jim Carrey playing the Riddler in Batman Forever, Batman and Robin. So it's not that good. Stop putting so much on this shit. It's just, it's a candy coated turd, put it that way. Okay. It's a candy coated turd. There's some stuff in it you can like. If you like special effects, you can like that. If you like concept and the idea, you can like that. If you like the fact that the father is trying to rescue his fucking daughter, you can like that. All the rest of the shit that was happening in that motherfucker could be problematic. Could be very problematic, especially if you're looking at it in the larger concept of what it means for men in general and how society and the culture is pushing things this way with men. You will have a goddamn problem with that. But that's besides the point. Like I said, look for the Project Power review coming. It should be coming out this week, and I'll go into my views on the shit. But today is all about DC fandom. Now, I will say for the most part, I am a comic book fan, but I'm primarily Marvel. I lean to the Marvel side of the geek, you know, spectrum. I lean heavy on the Marvel side. Spider-Man was my first love. The one that I grew up with alongside DC, the Justice League, and all of them. I grew up with all of these characters, but I primarily gravitated to Spider-Man first. And because of that, everything stems from Marvel, understanding the other comic book characters, understanding the different houses of comics, different publishers of comics. DC is one of those trinity for me of comic book creators or comic book companies that I like and enjoy. So I enjoy Superman movies. I enjoy Batman movies. I enjoy some of their TV shows. DC always does things a little bit differently than Marvel, and I'm fine with that because you should do things a little bit differently. It's DC Comics. It's not Marvel Comics. It's DC. So there should be some detective, some more adult stories, some more serious intellectual conversations and concepts going on in it. It should. Okay? It's a shitload of characters there. There should be plenty of stories. Don't have a problem with that. But I wouldn't say that I go to bat for DC all the time, because more often than not, DC rubs me the wrong way. And it makes it kind of hard to defend them in a lot of areas. And one of the areas where it was, has been hard to defend them is with their movies. Their movies have been of late, put it that way, since BVS, it's been kind of downhill with their movie franchises. And as far as the comics, some of the stuff that's gone on, it's been spotty. You can have 12 titles and two of them out of that group be hitting on something really good. The rest of them is just sucking wind. It's a fat boy running in a marathon. You know, they'll get to the finish line eventually, but it's going to take a while for the motherfucker to get there, okay? It's just what it's been. It's, I mean, that's kind of how it goes in comics. You have your up and down points. And DC is like treading water there, but they weren't doing that great. Not great in the sense that they end up getting bought out and AT&T came in and took them over. It tells you how well they're doing. So there had been rumors for a while of them being bought out and the comics are going away and all the rest of that shit. And everybody was saying it was just rumors. Well, as of a week or so ago, it's not a rumor. It's a fact, and it's been a done deal. So new people are at the helm. Old voices went. A couple of them stayed on, but the restructuring was serious. I'm about to get a customer right now, so you just
hello.
So if you hear me talking out loud, I'm just doing a live stream kind of thing. So I'm not being crazy. I will not answer myself.
Crazy's fine.
I won't answer myself, but you'll hear me talking. So it'll be good. So this is the beauty.
I'll still judge you if you say something crazy live stream or not.
That's fine. We can do that. This is an open conversation right now. So this is the beauty of recording in the shop for once, where you get customers coming in and they'll hear what you're talking about. And if they think you off base, like you just said, he will have something to say. That's why I never run out of material to talk about. And I don't necessarily get tired of talking about this stuff, because there's always a conversation about it in geek, always a conversation. So to get back on my point, DC was kind of messing up. So one of the things that DC was doing or planning to try to get that interest back in DC was the DC fandom, right? And apparently it was kind of the brainchild of Jim Lee, in a sense, which is all right. Jim Lee has been a pretty solid dude in comic books for, what did they say, damn near 30 years? I didn't even think it was that freaking long. But live. Stand-up comics. 8 o'clock. No, it's in store shopping. Live television. So DC fandom was kind of started by Jim Lee. And initially, it was supposed to be just a DC Universe thing, where it was going to be on DC Universe, and you had to be a sub to that app and that platform to be able to see it. But since the takeover by AT&T, they turned that around to free, because the DCU platform is going away. They're pulling their shows from that app, and they're putting them on HBO Max. So that's going away. If you didn't know that, I'm sorry. But that's what's happening. That thing was not making money. In the grand scheme of streaming services, it was the last horse in the race. So it was headed to the glue factory eventually. It's just the way it is. So because of that, DC fandom became not a exclusive thing. It became free to everybody, and they streamed it live over 24 hours and did this first block, which is all the movie stuff and television stuff and animation and games and all that big stuff. 24 hours for everybody live. Now, I tuned in yesterday and watched it live. That was an awesome presentation. It was the closest you will come to a comic convention during all this COVID stuff. And they did it really well. Okay. I have a whole separate pre-recorded on the DC fandom stuff because I didn't think I'd be able to get it all out during a live stream panel. But that video will be up after this video. So you get all my points on that. But a couple of things that I wanted to hit on were the things that stood out the most to me. And primary thing that jumped out there, which I'm not even thinking of as a big deal in lieu of everything else that actually happened, was the Snyder Cut trailer. Okay, everybody's been waiting on this for a while, this whole Snyder Cut thing for the JLA. And yeah, it looks like it'll be awesome. It'll be bigger, it'll be grander, it'll be stretched out. You'll get to see Zack Snyder's original vision without him walking away from it. You'll get to see Darkseid. You'll get to see a lot of other stuff that was supposed to be in a Justice League movie but never actually made it because it's a different director. And I don't say that to shit on the director that they had because I like that guy. You know, he is a good dude. He was coming into something. Put it this way. If I start building a house and halfway through it, you had to come in and finish it, but you're not a carpenter, don't be surprised if the house was not what you planned on initially. Different chef in the kitchen, different meal at the end of the service. It's just different. It's just a different style. It's just a different take. So it's actually funny to me to see how much people are all on board for a Snyder Cut now and darker tone and all that other shit when back at BVS, everybody was shitting on Zack Snyder because everything was too damn dark. But now they want all of that stuff back. That's pretty much funny. I mean, he somebody should be affixing said lips to his ass right now. Because that's what he does. You know what I mean? What the fuck? That's what he does. So the whole fandom thing, it led off with some of the Snyder Cut. And yeah, that was all nice. That was good. I got to see a trailer, got to see Darkseid and some of the other stuff that's going to go in there. That's all well and good. It's all cool. You got to hear Snyder talking about how a lot of other cuts are going back in, a lot of other scenes that were cut out, Superman, black suit, rest of the stuff with Batman, more Flash stuff, more with Cyborg being the heart of the team, all of that stuff. Don't put that in there. I just had to refund the guy's money today because he put it in before it was actually anything in there.
Cool. That's fine to be ready.
It's not even on right now. I have to turn it on. And it doesn't have a price in it. All right. That's one second, everybody. Yeah.
1 second. Get in and out as quick as I can. You guys have any comic book boxes?
No. Not at the moment. Those usually take a little bit to come in. So when we get them in, they usually sell out. All right, chip those in there. One second. And pick your receipt and hit the green button. You like it back?
I know.
All right.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good one.
You too. Thanks.
Okay, so back at it. Live television. This is why a lot of people don't do live television because nobody likes to go back and edit out all that ridiculous shit when other people came through and decided they wanted to have a moment to shock. Anyway. Cyborg being the heart of the team in a JLA movie. Yeah, you'll get more from Cyborg. He'll be more important like he probably should have been. And that'll make that actor a little bit more happy. The other big thing tangentially related to the whole Snyder Cut is Ben Affleck coming back in the Batman idea, right? Or coming back in the Flash movie. Now, here's the thing about that that most people misconstrue and don't understand. Yes, Ben Affleck is coming back to play the Batman character. He's not wearing tights. He is coming back to play Bruce Wayne in the Flash movie. But he's not coming back to put on the cape and cowl and stuff like that again. That's not the role he's playing. Okay. Now, I don't know what Ben Affleck's big aversion is to playing Batman again, but this is his send-off. This is his swan song for playing the Batman character in this Flash movie. That's why I say it's only tangentially related to the Justice League movie, because that version of Batman coming out of the Justice League movie was, he was kind of done with that Batman shit. He was kind of looking for a way to get killed. And that's not what Batman is. So him going away and giving him the opportunity to say goodbye to the fans, in a sense, is good. I hate that he's walking away from it, because I like Ben Affleck as an actor. I liked him as Bruce Wayne and Batman. He could actually perfectly fill both roles, which, looking like somebody who you would take serious as a businessman and actually looking like somebody imposing enough to put on that cape and cowl and kick your ass. I believed him. I believed him as a salty Batman, the old soldier, not for the BS. I believe that. But him coming back and getting to say goodbye to fans, okay, that's fine. If they could convince him to do it, would be awesome. But if they can't, it is what it is. What are you going to do? Actors get to choose. You're not forcing them to do this shit. They get to choose. So that was that on the Snyder Cut. Snyder Cut wasn't even the biggest thing that was in there. Right? I'm leading up to the biggest thing that was in there that came out. Because I have my notes and I'm going down my notes. Now, the next thing that caught my eye was The Rock and the Black Adam trailer stuff. This motherfucker big. The Rock is being really big right now. Now, Black Adam in and of itself is an imposing kind of character. Rock in and of itself is a big dude. Watching him and how they did this in this fandom piece where he's on a CG set, which is hand-drawn by Jim Lee, but the way they're putting the characters and the people in there to talk and stuff like that was really cool. It was a really cool way to show all of this stuff. And The Rock standing there within, you know, like a temple or something with these towering pillars and stuff like that, and him just standing there. I'm sitting there looking at this dude like, this motherfucker cut out of stone. Jesus. Look, me and Rock about the same age. We're about the same age. That motherfucker is in much better shape than me. And that's not a surprise, because I'm not a professional wrestler and I don't get paid for looking buff in fucking movies. But god damn, this motherfucker is cut. Now, if I'm looking at him, and for me as a geek, I'm just visualizing him in the Black Adam garb. And it didn't make it any better, because they showed their trailer, which is like a motion comic. And Black Adam looks like The Rock and is like, I totally see it. I buy it. I'm in. Like, he looks like the dude that can be Black Adam. I'm looking forward to that shit. The stop motion trailer looked awesome. I could watch the rest of that out until they came out with the live action movie. Wouldn't make a difference to me. But that looked really good. The Rock being there, and the guy he has playing Adam Smasher, how he's buffing up and stuff like that, it's gonna be a fucking beefcake fest in this motherfucker. Because understanding that The Rock in any movie brings up the level of physicality, and this, I wouldn't want to say stature, but put it this way. This is a simple way to put it. When The Rock showed up in the Fast and Furious movies, Vin Diesel had to go and buff up. And Vin Diesel ain't small already. He had to buff up. Rock coming into your movie steps up your fucking game. You need to look the part. Trust me. So seeing this little dude that's going to be in the movie as Adam Smasher and seeing him that, yeah, he working out and doing his exercises. Yeah, motherfucker, you got to share some screen time with somebody else who does this for real. Yeah, you better look like you hit a gym. You gotta do some shit. You gotta look like you hit the gym. And he's the his co-star, I'm forgetting his name, he working out. He buffing up. So that's good. Just from how The Rock is pitching this Black Adam stuff, that should look awesome. That looks like it's going to be awesome. And it's been a while, like they were saying, to try to get this to a point where it can be an actual movie. And that's the part that's the biggest change for me. Initially, when I heard about the Black Adam stuff, I thought that this was just going to be, he's just going to come into the Shazam movie and make an appearance and be there and be out. Because you have Shazam, you have to have Black Adam eventually. He was basically the first Shazam. About to get another customer. Hello.
Hi.
Hey. Hello to you. So I'm live streaming something right now. So if you hear me talking, don't worry. The camera's not on you. The camera's on me. It's not on you. So if you hear me talking about some stuff, don't get alarmed. I'm not crazy in that way. I am crazy, but not in that way. So, oh, great. We got another one. This is another regular customer. He knows what's going on. So I'm live streaming right now. So when you hear me talking out loud to myself, you don't have to answer in, but
okay.
And I'm not crazy.
Oh, no more than usual.
No more than usual. See, Larry knows my joke already. These people are new. They didn't know it.
Oh, okay.
So if you have 2 cents to throw in, you can throw it in, but you better be right, because I will attack.
I will be right.
I don't have to be right. You just have to be accurate. just it. It's like a shotgun or a sniper rifle, man. Like, look. We throw them pellets up there, but I got a rifle. I'm just saying. All right, so just to get back to it, The Rock coming into this stuff was not actually it's not what I thought it was going to be. He's not just going to be showing up in Shazam to do a one and done. He's showing up to be, you know, this character, and then he's in the movie and out. No, that's not what's happening. He's doing his whole own movie. That they're bringing Black Adam in as another member in this DC universe to have his own standalone movie. Maybe a franchise, I don't know, because from the trailer that they're showing, they have him rolling around with the JSA. You're getting Dr. Fate, Adam Smasher, and some of these other people in the movie with him, and that's not a side movie. That's his own movie franchise that he can go forward with. And the way The Rock is pitching the movie, he's pitching it as he's coming into the DC universe to find out who's the strongest. Like, he's looking for freaking Superman. I was like, holy shit, that is something completely different that I was not expecting at all. And now I'm a little bit more hyped about the movie because it looks like they're giving him the Scorpion King treat, that he's coming in and going to have his own franchise, regardless of how he might have started off as a side character in somebody else's stuff or not. He's coming in to take over. And for me, in my mind, Henry Cavill and The Rock, you know, side by side having a fight, that'll be some boss shit. Because them some big freaking dudes. That's like a legitimately buff Superman and legitimately beefed up Black Adam. That'll be something worth seeing. Because I read comics, so I'm sure Black Adam can get that ass. So I'm looking forward to seeing that movie above all. And how they're pitching it, he's coming to take over the DCU, which makes sense because The Rock is not coming in to just be a sidekick. It was nice to mention that shit years ago, but it makes more sense that he would come in and try to actually take over a franchise like he kind of took over the Fast and Furious franchise. They had to give him his own side movies because everybody else was getting pissed. But be that as it may, that's what's happening with the Black Adam. Now, the other part to this whole family thing that was the most surprising to me was the Milestone panel. Now, this was like a surprise panel. It wasn't advertised that this was going to be happening, but they did a whole surprise panel for Milestone Comics. And for the uninitiated who don't know, go back and read some of that damn comic books. What the fuck? This is a geek weekend. What are you doing? Read comic books. All Black comic book companies started in the 90s. Icon, Rocket, Hardware, Static Shock, Blood Syndicate, Shadow Cabinet, bunch of characters, right? Dwayne McDuffie, Denise Cowan, Reggie Headland. Some big names in this stuff. Now, when you get to this panel, you have the panel led off by Mark Bernard, which shout out to Mark Bernard. He does a lot of good work. I don't agree with him all the time, but him doing stuff with Kevin Smith was kind of fun because I like Kevin Smith, and him and Kevin got a good vibe going on between the two of them, which is funny to actually watch the two of them review or talk about anything because they just go back and forth. It's a rare find to have somebody who gets your humor. Like, you know, I had Larry Rowland in here feeding off of my joke about talking to myself. He knows what he's talking about. He gets me. So that works. That's why I like this place. So for the most part, he ran this panel, Denise Cowan, Reggie Hudlin, Philip Lamar, the voice of Static from the cartoons, and Jim Lee. They were all on the panel together, actually talking about this whole thing with Milestone and how Milestone Comics will be and their characters will be back come February of next year being put out as a regular book. Now, that was huge to me because you heard about this maybe a year or so ago where it was supposed to come out like March of the year before. And it just dematerialized. And there was murmurs that they were doing a lot of social justice stuff in the book, and it disappeared. Now, from what I had heard at the time, why it didn't come out then was that Dwayne McDuffie's widow was actually suing them because they never got her permission to actually put that stuff back out. And since Dwayne McDuffie was like a real founding member of that stuff, you needed his approval for those stories and some of those characters. So I don't know if they got it. I don't know what happened because I'm not sitting in the courtroom following that shit like that. Comes out, it comes out. I was suspect on some of the stuff I had heard earlier, so if it didn't come out, good. It's not trampling on anybody's legacy or image that way. But the panel was key because it let you know that there is actually serious attention and money being put behind this to make sure it comes out. And from the horse's mouth himself, the chief creative officer of DC Comics and publisher, Mr. Jim Lee, the new Lee in the comic book world, for his new role after this merger and acquisition by AT&T, he gets the green light and decide on most of the stuff coming out of DC. So in effect, he's like a Kevin Feige, or not Kevin Feige, but now I'm gonna forget his name in Marvel. Jesus Christ. You know who the hell I'm talking about. The guy over at Marvel. I'm forgetting his name right now because I said something else that I didn't want to say. I think it is Feige. But over at Marvel, where he's the last say-so in everything. Jim Lee in DC is now the last say-so in everything that gets done outside of the CEO of all of that stuff that decides how they're going to pay for all that crap. He's behind pushing the stuff. And the panel was interesting because you get to hear from Jim Lee about who's known for doing his own revolutionary things of being one of the founders of Image Comics and whatnot, telling everybody worldwide how Image Comics got their push from what Milestone was doing, because Milestone was first. Milestone was the first group of artists and writers who were trying to start their own imprint outside of the big two and actually push comics that reflected them out there. They were the first ones. And from his own accounts, they were the first ones to start up like, was it a whole party atmosphere with the release of a comic at a con and actually releasing stuff like that? They started that shit. That's from his mouth. Like, he's saying himself that they owe a lot of respect and gratitude because those guys were out there doing it. Those guys are out there trying to be really taken seriously, having their own book, dressed in suits and stuff. And him and the Image Boys are showing up in jeans and t-shirts, like jeans, t-shirts, and mullets. So it's pretty funny to see. But one of the things that comes out of that is you find out that these characters and these milestone characters, they're going to actually really live up to the Milestone Media imprint, because that's what it is. They're not putting out just comics. They're trying to hit all media. And from now until, I think he said September until February, when the comic launches, they're going to do all kind of online drops. And a lot of the online drops are going to be older material that's been digitized. So digitally, you can go back and read some of this older Milestone comics and get, if not seasoned, caught up on who these characters are, why they are important, and what types of stories they told and stuff before you get all the new stuff coming out of Cowan and Hudlin and Static and all these other characters. They also talk about movie stuff, because that's part of media. Movies is part of media. So they're trying to get this Static character into a movie. That could be really good. You've seen different shades and interpretations of that character and his power set in different movies. I could say Black Lightning, for all the good and the bad that it's doing on the CW. Black Lightning rips off a lot of stuff straight out of Static Comics. Powers and everything. They've been doing it for a while. So instead of farming off of these characters from Milestone, now they're starting to actually use these characters and put them back out there. Because understand, DC owns them. They own those characters. Instead of sitting them on the shelf to just pick off of, they're actually going to take those characters off the shelf and put them out there where other people can see it. So if you get a Static movie or Icon or Rocket movie, which would be more interesting to me, as long as it doesn't turn out looking like the Meteor Man, it would be awesome. I would enjoy that. I like seeing these characters show up again personally. Just show up again in comics and actually be tied in to the whole universe would be beneficial, because the characters in and of themselves were milestones and icons, but you need to have those characters out. I don't need 15 knockoff Supermans. I don't need three other knockoff black Supermen. You already have one. Throw Icon back out there. So that panel was good. That panel was really good. And I don't know how DC fandom is doing it, if they're going to have it available on the DC YouTube channel or not. But if you can find it, go back and watch some of that stuff, because it's a good, I don't want to say smattering, but a good smattering of stuff in there where they touch on everything that was involved. The other thing that stood out, speaking of other stuff involved, was the video games. There's two games that they announced on this, which look fabulous. The first of the two, and this is just one and two based on my interest level, is Suicide Squad Kills the JLA. Okay, it's kind of interesting. The trailer was funny because it's just animation. You know, animation of the Suicide Squad, King Shark, Captain Boomerang, Harley Quinn, Deadshot, you know, chilling and taking out characters leading up to being Superman. They got a problem. So that whole concept is interesting. Being that Attack on Arkham was so good because you actually got to be in the villain's shoes and gave people that interest in seeing more of the villain side of things as opposed to just the hero, or just seeing the villains through the hero's eyes, you get to see that these are just some other people and they have different ways of going about things. So you get to put yourself in their shoes. Playing those characters could be cool. Now, I don't know how the game is actually set up. Hopefully you can pick between those four characters and play each one of them, because I think I would just get more, I don't know, perverse humor out of playing King Shark, because you got to have some cool moves and some character animations. And I may not want to be a cannibal, but if you're playing King Shark, somebody's arm has to get eaten. I mean, come on. Jaws is a good movie, but sometimes you just want to be the shark. I'm just saying. So it could be interesting. That game could be interesting to see how that whole story shakes out and to see how it actually affects the DC universe now that everything's under one tent, so to speak. The other game that I'm really looking forward to playing is the Gotham Knights. That looks badass. Gotham Knights looks badass. And because it looks badass, I only have two reservations on it so far. First reservation is I don't like Batgirl's costume. I like Batgirl to have her do, but I don't like this that 2015, I'm a teenager again with boots and a makeshift costume, purple, yellow crap. I don't like that. It makes it look too much like the spoiler and not enough like Batgirl. It doesn't. So I don't like that costume too much. I'll deal with it because I'm not making a game. I'm just playing it, but that's one. The other one is another costume choice where they show Robin and he looks confused. It doesn't look like they know which one they're using. Hey, how are you? You hear me talking out loud? I'm just recording a live stream, so don't worry about it. You have a question? One second. What was the comic?
It's The Boys, Volume 3.
He didn't label it, but it's here. If everybody worked the same way, that would be like, I don't know, big business. Yeah, I remember ordering this for you. $16.49. Would you like a bag?
$16.49?
Mm-hmm. That works. Over is better than under. Seat and your change. Don't spend it all in one place.
Right.
Have a good one. What you got there, Larry?
Yeah, usual fun stuff. So I separated the stuff that's stuck on back issues with the pop and the other stuff right there.
Well, you think it's a back issue until it's.
Until it's not.
Until you scan it into the computer.
Whatever.
Then we'll find out if it's really a back issue or if it's just some stuff you put off the shelf but didn't mark down yet. He didn't pull it off the shelf. He didn't mark it down yet.
It's like, that one's like, you know, that I know that those haven't been $2.99 for a while. So,
no, yeah. But you're still getting a discount on it.
Okay.
Yeah. It's coming in at the right place. It's just,
yeah, just one of those things.
So this, for everybody, is one of my favorite customers, Larry, who has his family. And it's a geek with a family. He has kids. You know what that means? Geeks have sex. Not by themselves. Larry is what I call a normal geek, which is like me, which he holds down a job and takes care of serious business and stuff like that, but he likes his comic books. And he actually buys some quality. You'd be surprised, trust me.
Oh, yeah.
Art of it more. Just saying, dude. You still reading Star, I mean. But Larry is who I talk to when I have my HR questions when I was doing my supervisor's gig and getting my stressors.
Oh, yes, all that time.
He showed me the HR delineations.
Whatever it takes, right?
No kidding, Chip right there. So Larry's good people. And his son is good too, but I like and hate seeing his son every time because his son is like kind of grown now. Comes in with his own car and got a little scruff on his face and stuff like that. And I remember that little fresh-faced little kid coming in here like,
yeah,
told you to grow up. Oh. I tease him, but I actually put his name in the computer as the man. That's who he is now.
That's right.
Because he's kind of a grown-up when you start paying for your own comics.
Yep. And he shaved yesterday. So
he found a razor?
He's shaving again.
You let him close to something with a blade on it? With no supervision?
No, he did that all on his own.
Holy cow, you understood, huh? It had to happen sooner.
Well, you know.
Two more to go, huh?
Yeah, well, you know, my youngest, he doesn't know what a razor is at this point. I mean, even though we bought him one for, I think, around his 12th or 13th birthday, something like that. Mm. You know, he just turned 15. Forget it.
Yeah, 15? Yeah. Wait till 16. He'll figure it out.
Yeah, we'll see.
And that girlfriend's, ooh, your face is rough. I'm like, yeah, any razor.
He still has it. It's in the bathroom. So he actually has an electric razor if he so chooses. I won't let him have the blade yet.
No.
No.
Not unless you want to take him to the hospital.
No. Exactly. So I like what you're talking about with the milestone.
Really? Yeah. That was a good panel. It was a really good panel.
I didn't see any of it, but
wow.
But I was too busy, being responsible, darn it. Someday I'll actually get
regular geek shit, responsibilities.
Yeah. It says you only get to read stuff like this, like late at night or something like that when you need to.
Everybody good? Everybody good?
Yeah.
Everybody ate? You in your room doing your thing? Good. Yeah. Leave me alone. I'm reading my books.
That's right.
I'm going to read my comics.
That's what we got to do.
That's what it is. So, what's the other guy? Peppers. You know, he works in a jail. He's a cop working in a jail. When does he get time to read his comics? Everybody has gone to their cells and they're in bed for the night. He can sit down in the tower and read his books. I'm like, regular geek, hold down a regular job.
He's got to have days off.
He's got to have his little mental escape.
You have to. And actually, I put something out on Facebook last night about in a similar vein where we definitely need any moments we can of some positivity and some hope. And, we need whatever kind of, escape or, positive message we can get, whether it's, superheroes doing something for the better good, or a little Star Trek with Future Hope, or maybe just some love and positivity from the Beatles, whatever.
That's what I've said about comics for a little while. It's like I want to see people being creative because we're bogged down enough in reality right now about what's happening. I need something to show me something a little bit ahead of this, which is a little hopeful for me to get to, as opposed to let's drag the comics right here too. Like, look, I don't need everything in the mud with me, okay? Exactly. Something has to be the lifeline. Has to be the lifeline.
And we also don't need nearly so many post-apocalyptic futures either, because we're living too close to that these days. And
it's almost there, okay? Don't worry about it. We got this new post-apocalyptic story. I'm like, wow, that won't be what, next year or so? Like, come on. You're going to put a date stamp on this next week? What? Come on.
Well, I thought they already covered that in Batman. Wasn't that Cataclysm in the Pandera thing? That was, the early 2000s?
Yeah, it's like we covered this already.
Dude. Yeah.
This is here. It's like Buck Rogers leaving in 97. We're past that.
We're done.
Let's start somewhere else now. We're good. We got this part covered.
Exactly.
Get imaginative. You got a lot of time indoors.
Well, that's what we need the comics for.
That's exactly what the comics are for. A lot of time indoors, and people need to read something.
Find a good story and settle in.
Exactly. Exactly my point.
All right, Tony.
All right. Good seeing you, Larry. Have a good Sunday.
Yes.
I'm sure Florida will be back next week. He's just taking care of some personal stuff this week.
Well, that's okay. I always look forward to seeing you. It's all good.
It's all good.
And, I just always feel fortunate when I get the opportunity.
It's like
some weeks I don't even know if I ever get in here.
Yeah, it's like, what is it? Like Poltergeist. All are welcome. Come, children. All are welcome.
Exactly.
I'm a little taller than the midget, though.
How about we think about it more like Cheers, where everybody knows your name?
I always think of this place as Cheers.
Exactly.
That's why I call everybody by name, except the new people. I don't know their names.
Just as long as we don't yell Norm, we're okay.
No, but next time you come in, I will yell Larry. I'm just telling you ahead of time since you reminded me.
Well, the thing is that if we're going to go that route, we'll take a cue from like Mel Brooks and so on. And instead of, Norm, it's Abby Normal.
Abby Normal. We have a customer named Abby, too. So
all right, Tony.
All right, Larry. Have a good one. Well, that's part of the fun. Yeah, what are you looking for?
Spawn? Yeah, Spawn.
No Spawn.
No Spawn. How about, you don't happen to have like a Batman Superman annual 4 or any Batman Beyond stuff?
No Batman Beyond stuff in there. It would be in the back issue, but it's not high value. High value over here is usually like, late 60s, early 70s.
Okay.
So it wouldn't be a lot of 80s, 90s stuff now.
Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Boom, boom, boom. So that is the Beautio Shop. And Larry hit on it. That's one of the reasons why I like this and why I try to bring that feel to the channel is that most of the people who come in here are usually regulars. Like regulars in the sense that they have been coming here for decades since the shop opened up. So we all know each other pretty much from here. So when you go to a con or out in public or something like that, you see somebody somewhere, it's like, I know you from somewhere. And it's funny the reactions you get because some people get kind of put off by that if you meet them in outside of a context and you say, hey, what's going on? They're like, how do you know me? Like, comic shop. Like, okay. Before then, that look of horror on their face, like somebody knows my secret. And that was one of the things that Philip Lamar said on the Milestone panel that was key. And he said, at one point during the show, he opened up his button-down shirt, his baseball shirt that he had on, and he had a Static Shock symbol shirt on. And he said he had that shirt since Dennis Kalanick gave it to him like 20, 30 years ago, right? And he's making a joke that it wasn't easy being a nerd back then. What was the exact quote? I want to make sure I quote him correctly because it is a quote. I don't want to screw that up because you can't go around misquoting people unless you're the president. Then you can misquote people all day long inaccurately. What did he say? There was a time that being a nerd was not cool, especially for a black dude, which is true. There was a time. I lived through that time. That's why I'm an old geek now and not a millennial geek. I've been through having to have those fist fights because you like the shit. And people thinking that you would be living in a basement somewhere living off your parents and never having a woman in your life because you like reading comic books. I like having an imagination, and that wasn't my path in life. So much for people trying to tell you who you are. So anyway, moving on. So just to speed it along, Aquaman had a panel, which was interesting. The most interesting part about that panel was not that they're having another movie. Obviously, they're getting another movie. They're using the same director as the last time, which is James Wan. So James Wan is going back and doing Aquaman 2 as well. Orm is going to be in it. The actor who played Orm, Ocean Master, he's going to be in the second movie as well. Obviously, Jason Momoa is coming back. Funny part is that they did have what's her name in the trailer, but we already know she's not coming back from their recasting. She's out of that stuff for her shadiness with Johnny Depp. So she's out. But the most interesting thing from that panel for me, because there wasn't anything for them to show, was that seeing James Wan. Now, I've seen a couple of his movies. I've never actually seen him on camera. That dude looks like a kid. I mean, he looks like he might be 25. He does not look like a grown man directing these movies. But seeing him and seeing him interact with his other actor and laughing and stuff like that, you get a sense for his personality, and it makes sense why his movies are always so colorful and there's humor and stuff like that in them. That is him. That is his personality all day. And just him doing that little panel was enough to say, okay, that's just his personality. It's like, okay, you have your personality on screen. I think anybody watching that would believe that their children could grow up to be directors because he looks like a child. I didn't know he looked that young. And it's pretty funny to me, but he does decent movies. So I'll look forward to seeing what Aquaman 2 is going to bring out. They said they were going to go to some other places in Atlantis, which would be interesting, and introduce some new stuff, which would be very interesting. So I'll look forward to seeing that. The next one that comes up is one of the big ones in this stuff, which is Wonder Woman 84. Okay, they put out the final trailer for that, and you got to see Cheetah in all her glory. Now, they don't have to sell me on Wonder Woman. I was going to see Wonder Woman anyway. They didn't need a final trailer for that shit. I know it will come anyway, but they didn't need a final trailer for that. The first trailer sold it just enough. I was all in from that point. I was going to see Wonder Woman too. And for me, Wonder Woman always goes back to like Super Friends and the Justice League or whatever. But for me, in my age, it's Linda Carter. Linda Carter has always been Wonder Woman, right? And them doing this paddle with Patty Jenkins, Gal Gadot, and Linda Carter was a good call out, because I hope that they put her in the movie somewhere. I hope they put her in the movie somewhere, because I thought that was an opportunity that they missed in the first movie, that they didn't put her in there as Hippolyta or somebody. Should have been somewhere on that freaking island. I mean, this, come on. One of the things DC does well to me is actually give their callbacks to older actors who have portrayed their characters in any form or fashion. You always are able to get into something else from DC, and they will throw you in there and give you that shot. They missed the opportunity having her in there that first time. Maybe they get it right in 84, she'll be in there. Who knows? Maybe she'll show up like Stan Lee and she's an actress trying to do something. I don't know. Sky High. I don't know. Shit. You know, so maybe. But having her on the panel with Gal Gadot was pretty cool. The final trailer for seeing Cheetah is good. I covered it more so in my fandom pre-recorded that'll come out. So if it sounds like repeat, it's unavoidable. I didn't think one would happen before the other, but it looks all right. It could probably be polished a little bit more, how the character looks, but it was only a quick glimpse. So you can chalk that up to them being clever or just how the character looks, but we'll see. I think most of the action with the cheetah will probably happen before she turns completely into, you know, the furry beast that she's supposed to be. But for the most part, it looks good. I still want them to stop teasing with this invisible jet shit and just throw it in the damn movie that is there, because obviously the main scene that they keep showing of Wonder Woman running down the street and throwing her lasso and grabbing something and getting whisked off into the air, she's not fucking flying. She wrote the invisible jet. We know it's there. They keep showing the scene of her and Steve Trevor flying along in some fucking jet. It's there. It's a given. Just show a design or something like that once. It's invisible. You're not going to see it very long anyway. So just call it a day and get over with. Otherwise, I did like what Patty Jenkins had to say on that panel. She's actually coming off not so unreasonably a feminist, put it that way. That she understands that she never saw herself any different. She never saw herself as a female director. She only saw herself as a director. It didn't matter that she was fucking female. She made movies to make movies. And that was the more interesting part, because she put one thing in front and not the other one in front. She never saw herself in a separate fucking class just because she was a female, which makes sense. You're a director. I'm not a director. And if I was a director, they wouldn't primarily look at me as a male director. They would just say he's a director. So that part is more important. So I think that's why the movie that you got for Wonder Woman was a lot better than what you got for Captain Marvel, because one person put the other thing in front and the other one just put the director in front. And that's why you had a better movie. So that's one of the reasons why I'm looking forward to seeing this next iteration of this character in Wonder Woman 84. So I'm looking forward to the movie. I'm actually really pumped for this movie, and some of the extra stuff they put into the trailer shows some extra scenes. I don't want to see any more. Thank God this is the final trailer, because I don't want to see any more of that movie until it's on a screen that I can view it on, COVID or not. Because for me, trust me, I'll still go to the movie theaters during the COVID time, because most of the time when I go to the theaters, I don't want a packed theater anyway. And if nobody's going to be there and they still open up the theater, good. Then I'll have it to myself and nobody will talk over my movie experience. So I'll still be there. Put my mask on. Oh, well, full hazmat suit. But there's certain things I'd like to see in the theater, and a brand new movie I want to see in the theater. And I don't need a lot of people in there, because I don't want a lot of people in there. Truth be told. So, talked about the Flash movie, talked about Aquaman. Shazam 2 was interesting. The Shazam 2 panel was interesting in the fact that Zachary Levi was there leading the panel, and he was talking about how much he could not say about the next movie. And he kept going on with that, and I'm like, well, how are you going to do this damn panel? I mean, there's nobody here, nobody talking. But as it unveiled, other actors from the show showed up, Megan Good and some of those other characters showed up, and they're talking and whatever, and it turned out to be the funniest freaking panel that they had. That was the funniest panel, because they're all riffing off of each other in this main theme of not being able to say anything about the movie, but they drop stuff about the movie the whole time. You got the title, you got the poster art, you got a lot of stuff that was thrown in there just by, like, it's supposed to be like happenstance, but the whole panel was funny. So it actually played off that sense of, well, we can't say anything, but look, we drew this picture and here it is. But that's actually the thing. It's not something that's not the thing. It's actually the thing. So it made it more entertaining and a more fun panel to see. It stood out. It stood out for the most part. So I do look forward to seeing the Shazam 2, because the first Shazam hit a good vibe with me. It hit a good family oriented type of situation. Although some of the stuff that happened was kind of goofy, it works. That character, I remember a character back in the day with the live action TV show. That was always a little bit more interesting to me, to have a hero or a child in a hero spot, because he's going to get into some goofy shit. I mean, for the most part, if you were seeing Deadpool in movies and stuff like that, what is that? That's a teenage pubescent boy in, you know, a badass mercenary spot. That's what you're getting, pretty much, because his mentality is about the same. So it can be entertaining, and DC hit that pretty good with Shazam, which was an entertaining movie. If you remember that year, most people didn't think it was going to be any good, and it actually ended up being really good, surprisingly so. So it's holding to the tone that the movies that people are not paying that much attention to, from these other characters that everybody is not so overly invested in and believing they know the absolute right way this character should be written, portrayed, and all the rest of the shit, end up being the ones that hit it the hardest and hit it the best, because they have some room to be creative. After 40 to 80 years of the character being around, trust me, there is not one version of any of these damn characters right now. There isn't. And you need to look through all of that stuff and try to get to the core of what this character is and what it's about. Some stuff can change. Some stuff just don't fucking matter. The necessary, I don't know if I want to say this, but the necessary color of a character may not matter. If you take it out of the context of when the character was made, it was all white characters. They just were. That's just what it was. Doesn't matter. Maybe. If that, I'd say if you made a superhero out of a Klansman and fast forwarded him 40 years into the future, and now you're making a live action movie of it and change that character to black, yeah, it would matter. It would be an issue. It just doesn't work that way. It works in comedy. See Dave Chappelle, but it doesn't work necessarily for every character. So we'll see how some of this stuff goes. Some changes need to be made, and I'm fine with that when it jumps media. Shazam being a little bit more goofy, fine. I want to see the kid in the superhero's body, you know, acting up and getting into trouble. For a second movie, should be interesting, because I want to see where they go with this, especially since they introduced Superman at the end of the first one. Can't show the tights and the cape and not have Henry Cavill or somebody show up in there. Got to. You know The Rock is coming. You know Black Adam is coming. Put some people in there and let's see what happens. So, is that the last one? I don't think that's the last one. The DC television stuff was decent. I got to get a look at the new Batwoman. She was on one of the panels about females in comics and diversity in females in comics. It was all the black actresses from all the other CW shows and whatnot doing a panel. And on the panel was the new actress, Javica Leslie or something like that, who's taken over Batwoman from Ruby Rose. That's interesting. Is she going to be in a lesbian in the show? I don't fucking know. I don't know how they can have Batwoman and get rid of Kate Kane. That's the character. I don't get it, but whatever. You know, Ruby Rose wanted to walk away from the role. I guess it was getting too physical for her. It's Batwoman. But whatever. I think she was trying to get off a sinking ship while it was still a bit buoyant. And she found a home over in Star Wars, supposedly with Kathleen Kennedy and their little deal that they're doing over in Star Wars world. So we'll see if she actually shows up or what shakes out from that. But the new chick is in. Batwoman will be black for season two. And I guess everybody will see what that's going to be from there. Don't know how long that show is going to be on, but that's the direction that they're going with that. So last part of this, and then I'll just end it there and go on to the other stuff. let you guys do the little camel thing, is the biggest show out from this whole DC fandom, which was the trailer for the Batman, or Matt Reeves' The Batman. Damn. Now, I was suspect on this movie when it was first announced, because I didn't understand why we needed another Batman so soon. I said the same thing when Ben Affleck was going to show up and be the next Batman so soon after the last one. So, dude, why are you oversaturating me with fucking Batman? Thought it was one of these guys. Robert Pattinson playing Batman was, you've heard me clown, Glitterbat was like a joke to everybody who heard that Robert Pattinson was going to be the next Batman. How it fit into this whole DC universe was a bigger question, but everybody was saying that it was its own movie, it's its own thing. Like, okay, fine, do your shit. We'll see what happens. Now, suspect on the whole thing. I'll let him, you know, I'll show up and watch a movie with him in it just to see what it's going to be, but I'm still like, you're going to have to win me over. Trailer. If I was, you know, what, 30% on board for the movie, a trailer bumped me to a solid 90. A trailer sold that damn movie. Completely sold the movie. You got to see some action. You got to see the characters involved in it. You got to see the setting. You got to see the tone. That kind of sold me. And I will say, this is the second time DC has done that shit to me. Because if you remember, I wasn't sold on the Joker movie initially with Joaquin Phoenix. Not at all. But what happened? Put out a trailer so somebody can see what you're actually trying to do. I was on board. Release some story details about how you were getting to this killer. Okay, I'm on board. Trailer came out, blew everybody out the water. Was ready to see it. Movie came out. Blew the fuck up. So Matt Reeves taking his stab at Batman and it not being connected to any of that stuff. He's going to go his own way with this. Was an interesting take. Seeing that trailer. I'm on board for whatever the fuck you're doing. I want to see this movie because it was the right amount of kind of creepy, a little unsettling, and that shit was brutal. I don't get off on brutality for brutality's sake, but understanding where this Batman is coming from, where he is still new with this. This is a year two Batman, and he ain't been doing this for 20 years and got it all figured out. That was going to be the seller. Robert Pattinson trying to deliver a physical performance was going to be the seller. And they knew this. And I think that's why they put that main scene in the trailer to where you get the group of guys. They look like Joker masks. I don't think they're Joker masks. It's just the whole movie is supposed to be based off the Long Halloween. So it's supposed to be a Halloween setting. That's why a bunch of people are running around with face paint on it. But that dude walking up on him and saying something stupid, and he just, you seeing a fixed shot, no cutaways of him just doing the movements and breaking this dude down and just going in just hardcore. It looks like it's going to be some rough shit. I'm in for that. Year two Batman, I'm in for that, because that is not the polished, you know, head of the Bat family. That's somebody out there trying to survive a night. You ready to go?
Yes, I am.
Okay, 1 second. I was getting into the good shit.
Sorry.
It's okay. I have a big head, so I can remember stuff. You guys find everything okay?
Yeah, thanks. Yeah.
What are you talking about? I don't know what you're talking about. There's a lot of stuff in here. You can buy a lot of it. two issues back to you?
I'm not sure.
It was in the box. I honestly saw this one.
Yeah, two and three.
Yeah, they're reading both books.
Okay. I don't want to put together, but sometimes you make mistakes.
You get a bag and board for that if you have it. Awesome. Thank you.
Okay. This, first. All right. You get. So this is one of the fun things about working in a shop where you see what other people buy.
Oh.
And what people are interested
in. Oh, I'm big.
Yeah, you got to get up on this for the boys three. Y'all need to learn how to read books. This is what's coming in the boys. That is going to be some classic geek television. They even try to go anywhere close to that. Oh my God. I mean, it's me laughing about the degradation of society or the improvement of it. But it's going to be some hilarious shit, to say the least. Oh, that show. That show. I met the artist of that show and talked to him for a while, right? Never read his damn book. Saw the show, understood what it was coming from. It's like, okay, there's a lot of comics. I can't read everything.
Yeah.
Can't read everything all the time. I don't have that kind of time. Seeing that show, like, the fuck?
And then
having to go back and read some of those issues, my God, dude, why was I not reading this earlier? Why was I not reading this when it was new? This is one of my favorite writers, too. I wasn't even reading it then. I was like, holy cow.
That's a cool idea, though. Like, if someone, if a human without powers, what could you do in a world where it is superhumans?
You figure out a way. Yeah, that's what butchers that do. Figure out a way.
Their mind is what they found people more powerful
than that. Yeah. Well, that was the whole thing. That was part of the thing with the book, The Authority. The Authority were supers that went after other superhero or super people who were acting bad. So The Authority was made up of drunks and drug addicts and, you know, depraved people. But they went after those type of people who were supposed to be heroes, but they were really some deplorable ass people.
Yeah.
And they went after them hardcore. Like, dude, we had to kill that guy. Like, you killed him? What are you doing? It was like one of the scenes that sold it was there was a Superman character in that, which was Apollo. And they had a whole rip on DC, which was Apollo and Midnight, which is, looks like Batman and Superman.
Uh-huh.
Well, they're homosexual lovers. They're married. They're husbands, right? But they go up into a fight against this knockoff version of the Avengers.
Okay.
And they're fucking, they're mean as fuck, right? And they're talking shit to these people of the Authority, right? And their shaman, their doctor, right? He's a drug addict. He gets cocaine. He has abilities, but he does heroin and shit, right?
Is it a comic?
Yeah, this is a comic.
Oh,
yeah. This is Authority, right? Early version of the Authority. And he shows up to this fight against these knockoff Avenger characters, and he's puking and shit. And the Giant Man character is looking at him like, what the hell kind of hero show up to a fight intoxicated and stuff? Yeah. Right after he says that, his freaking head blows out. Oh, it's the Apollo, the Superman character, flying through his head like a bullet, yelling the dangerous kind. I'm like, don't fight! Just kill this dude! I'm like, oh my God. After that, it gets rougher because the Authority loses that fight and they beat the hell out of Apollo. And Midnighter is pissed. Right? Next time they fight them, and it was the Captain America character who beat the hell out of the Apollo character because he was beating him up because he was gay and all kind of other shit. All kind of epithets rolling out of his mouth and stuff while he's beating the hell out of this character. Like, oh, that was bad. Well, Midnighter wanted a piece of him, right? They go for round two. Apollo has been flying around the Earth, staying in the path of the sun, just charging it. They get into this fight. They get down to the Captain America knockoff, and he lasers his fucking spine, right? He's trying to run away. He just shoots him with eye blast right in his spine, paralyzed and laying down on the ground, right, in front of Midnighter. And he's cussing and fussing at Apollo. Why don't you finish me? Why don't you do this? Whatever. He said, I promise you to somebody else. And he looks up, and Midnighter is standing there with a jackhammer and a spike behind his ass. And he's like, hello, sunshine. I'm like, holy cow. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God, dude. It was the early authority was some rough business. It was Warren Ellis going ham. He knocked off the Avengers. He knocked off the knockoff JLA. He knocked off the Fantastic Four, the freaking X-Men.
That was awesome.
Oh, my God. He went at everyone. It was Image.
Whoa, really?
It was Image. Authority was hardcore. they went at everybody. And that's why I kind of shut that down.
That's why, like, the boys, it's like the, at least even the TV series, it's like really dark. And it's really what really humans would be like. I mean, most comics, it's like everything's all peachy keen, you know, everybody's all nice and stuff. And in reality, if that really happened, the more power you have, you know, it's going to crush.
Well, that was the whole point of The Watchmen. It's like, okay, these people have these power. Why would you trust them?
Because
they still have all their same moral conflicts as regular people. They're regular people with power. They can do whatever the hell they want to. And The Boys totally plays it up like, these ain't well-adjusted people. Whatever, dude.
They're like behind the scenes. They're okay. Great.
So 32-74. Yeah.
You like the Umbrella Academy?
Yes. Series? Yeah.
I think that the, what's his name? The guy who sees dead people is similar to that, where he's in order to numb himself of the seeing dead people, because the backstory of when he was a kid, he got locked into a closet. And
locked actually, in the closet to learn how to talk to dead people. Like, that's like emotional trauma, dude.
And that's why he trusts himself.
Yeah. So he can shut the voices out. There was another comic that played on that, because the guy who did Umbrella Academy, he's a musician.
Yeah.
So you can see where he's pulling all these different elements from other comics, because he's a geek, right? But Rising Stars did it, and Rising Stars is written by J. Michael Straczynski, and his character, who could see dead people, he lived a fucking Rome. Okay. And he was like, everybody thought he was weird and really standoffish. It wasn't that he was standoffish. Is that they got to one page in the book, and one of the other characters is talking to him and said, you know, we're sorry to leave you here alone or whatever. He said, don't worry, I'm never alone. And if you don't understand what's happening, you'll turn the page and the next page is white and it has all these people on it. But you go to this page, it's just him sitting in a chair in the room. Well, what you're supposed to do is hold it up to the light. And when you hold it up to the light, it shines through. It's all these ghosts in the room at the same time talking to him. And that's why he's sitting there trying to be calm, like, I'm never alone. They're always fucking talking to him. He is not a happy character. He is fucking miserable. And he didn't take drugs.
Yeah.
So that's why Seance and Umbrella Academy is more fun. Like, yeah, he tried to tune that out. He tried to turn that volume down on the voices, because it's bad enough having yourself and your conscience in your head. You don't need 15 other things around there. Like, why don't you talk to me? Because you're dead and annoying. Yeah, so Umbrella Academy is good. I really enjoy that book and that story and that show. The show is more fun than anything. So
you could just count on the Civil War. It's just near
minimal. No, that's I only do the price that's marked. I can't actually mark it down in price. But it's probably gonna come up discounted anyway, because it's a back issue and we're doing a sale right now.
Oh, cool.
So it's probably not even $15. I think it's 50% off right now. So that'll make it actually good.
I like the second season of the book is way better. The Dallas comic is way better than.
Yeah, because they're changing a lot of stuff for the show, which is which is what?
I actually like the part in the comic where Samus actually follows him in Vietnam,
mm-hmm.
and he's got a lot of trauma just from going to Vietnam, and they didn't really cover it a lot.
Well, they covered it in season one that he went to
Vietnam. Yeah, it was like the last episode of it.
Yeah, it was a little closer to the middle where he disappears, and you'll see what happened in Vietnam.
Yeah.
The guy he fell in love with, and all the rest of that, and then he comes back.
Yeah.
So you know he was gone to Vietnam and what he went through. Second season, they talk about it briefly, but you see him meeting the guy that he will eventually meet.
Yeah.
Trying to save him. Yeah. Which, in a sense, could be that you're fucking up your own timeline because that's how he ends up in Vietnam. Just kept your mouth shut and that would have saved him. you could be the reason he's dead right now. You know that, right?
Yeah, fair enough.
Time travel, man. You can't mess around with it. All right. There you go, folks.
Have a good one.
You.
You too, have a good one. Enjoy your comics. And not this book. All right, so I'm back. That's just life in a comic shop. So where was I? Batman. Brutal. Now, I also went into this a little bit on my fandom video, but look. Robert Pattinson looks fucking crazy. He looks crazy in a crow kind of way. That he is out there trying to do some, I wouldn't even say good. I think he's out there just for real getting vengeance. And that's what it looks like. It looks like a guy taking out his anger on these fucking criminals. And that part is interesting to me. This one being more of a detective story is superbly interesting to me because that's what Batman is supposed to be. He's supposed to be Sherlock Holmes of the DC universe. Not just The Question, but Batman. There is a tier in DC Comics that Batman sits at. And if you want tech and detective work, he sits at the top of that shit. Mind you, it's called Detective Comics for a reason. It's supposed to be this gritty, street-level police work type of deal, and Batman sits at the top of that hierarchy. So I'm looking forward to seeing this movie. I like the early versions of Catwoman that you see in it with Zoe Kravitz, because I just like Zoe Kravitz. But yeah, I'm looking forward to that. That trailer just blew my freaking mind. Blew my fucking mind. So I'm looking forward to seeing that more than anything. The song choice for the trailer, that was a home run. That sells it. Color scheme sells it. Going with the black and red for Batman and not the whole black or gray or white and yellow or any of that shit. They went with a black and red. And it's the Batman. Like, okay, Matt. I see you, Matt Reeves. Okay. Okay, that's what you're doing. All right, cool. Not a big deal. That in and of itself is more of the selling point for DC. And I'll tell you, coming out of that whole show, which is interesting, is that they turned me around on DC. I'm very hopeful about what I see coming on the horizon in DC. I'm very hopeful. And if it's all Jim Lee's call on some of this shit, good job, Jim Lee. Thank you for doing that shit, because y'all needed it. DC needed it. They didn't need it so much with its animation, because animation has been solid for a while. Video games have been solid for a while. Television, so-so. Movies, the movies that did the best from them were the ones they weren't putting that much emphasis into. Aquaman, Wonder Woman, Shazam. The ones they threw all their money into, BVS, JLA, screwed the pooch. screwed it hard till it start meowing. Yeah, shit the bed. So seeing this stuff that's coming out now and going forward, I'm on board. I'm on board for the Batman movie with Robert Pattinson. Look, actors are actors. If half of what I saw in this, the Batman trailer of him acting, is how he will be interesting in Tenet, my fucking view of Robert Pattinson will completely fucking shift. Because he got two movies that I'm looking forward to now that can do really well. The Tenet movie, I'm in there all fucking day. I'm in there all day because I like Christopher Nolan movies. I like intellectual movies. And that's what he does. He doesn't do it simply, and he doesn't cheap out on shit. He go all in. If Robert Pattinson gives a marked, interesting performance in Tenet and then follows it up with a solid performance in Batman, he will have successfully wiped away any of that Twilight shit he ever did. He will. He will successfully have wiped that from everybody's fucking mind that it happened. Because understand, as an actor, you play a lot of roles, and a lot of the actors I like, I've been watching for a long time since they were either child actors or early in their career. And if you go back and look at some of the movies they were in, they did shitty movies. It fucking happens because they're actors trying to get on and build up their portfolio and build up their resume and build up their skill. Okay. I would never think that what I can do as a journeyman should totally be based on what I did as an apprentice because I didn't know this shit. I was just learning. A cut that I can make today is not the same cut I made my first weekend as being a carpenter. It's not. I do a lot of shit now with no guys and freehand and motherfuckers be looking like, how you know how to do that? Because I've trained in this craft. And I've been doing it for a long goddamn time. That's hundreds and thousands of cuts. Same thing with acting. What you do in your early career shouldn't be the same thing you're doing in later in your career. That you should be getting better at your craft, which means over the hundreds and thousands of hours of screen time in acting and rehearsals and practicing your craft, you get better to the point where you can master it. So Robert Pattinson can turn his whole fucking career in a different direction based on this Batman shit. Can. Because Batman and Tenet will show you two different sides of Robert Pattinson. So from the trailer, I'm all on board for that shit. I'm all on board for that movie. I really want to see this movie now. The last one I'm forgetting, I'm thinking of it last because I'm trying to sew this up a little bit, but The Suicide Squad. This was a fun panel. In a Hollywood Squares type of sense, this was a fun panel. James Gunn coming on to do this movie and what he's turning out from what he showed, the trailer that he showed from behind the scenes and stuff like that. I'm interested in this movie too. I'm really interested to see what he put forth because it looks like it's going to be some badass shit happen. Regardless of the characters looking goofy as fuck. It's a Suicide Squad. These motherfuckers are dying. Some of them are dying. So when you're looking at this panel and how they did it in fandom with this large, it has to be a Zoom cast because StreamYards ain't hosting that many people at one time. They're just not. It was 18, 20 people on one stream, and they're having this whole conversation, but it's happening in this virtual space. That's like the best part of a comic convention, going and seeing the panel with all the actors there, the directors, the creative staff, all sitting down having this conversation and you being able to witness this conversation with them. That's the best part of it. And that's what this DC fandom was. It was the virtual equivalent of a comic convention happening live. It was good. And it reached all over the world. Different hosts for different sections from different parts of the freaking world. It was really good. It was a really good thing. So, Suicide Squad, I'm up for watching that. It looks like it'll be interesting. It looks like it'll be gritty. Putting the dirt back in comic book movies and the realism, because too much fantasy and unrealistic stuff, at least nowadays. Yeah, I don't know. It's a tough road to walk. Because it's a live action movie, it needs a degree of realism. It can't have some fantastical elements in it, but it needs a degree of realism to ground it. Unless you're going to a full unrealistic movie, which may not hit everybody you're trying to hit. Because understand, when they make a movie, they're trying to hit the biggest demographic possible. And they're not just looking for people like me who've read the comics and know the characters. They're not looking for just people like me. People like me, just us, who read comics and stuff like that, aren't making these movies blockbusters. Just understand that shit. We're not. We're not pushing it past $1 billion mark. It's people like us that get people who are like the people that just walked out of the store who are casual comic book readers and regular moviegoers to understand what's happening and getting the bug of excitement of watching this stuff. Because best believe the people that were just in here, these are not regular comic book readers. They're not. But they're reading this shit because the comic jumped the medium to something that they watch more regularly. A medium they use more regularly, which is television. And that television show drew them in to the comic world to get the rest of the story or the real version of the story. And that's where jumping mediums help. It helps in the sense that it can bring more people back to the source and back to the root of it. And for me, that's what it's always about. You always go back to the source. This is the source. These comics are the source. You go back to the source. No matter what you liked on TV or movie, you go back to the source and get the real, unrefined shit. Because then you'll see what it was. They're in here buying Harley Quinn and some of the boys' stuff that they're looking forward to, but they don't know anything about the Authority. And that book was a game changer when it came out. So that means they're casual. They're very casual. And they need to learn this. And so that's my job. My job is to get you here and catch you up a little bit to everybody else and give you some other things that you can read and get into and understand that there's more out there shit in this world than just the one thing you saw on one show. So that's going to be it for me right now. I'm not going to go into all the YouTube stuff because, frankly, I was only able to listen to stuff on Monday, and I haven't caught up on all the rest of the goings on YouTube, but from what I saw on Monday with Kendra and the Angry Man, Sphere is on a good course. Sphere is on a good course. So I'd like to see that going forward. I don't know about no Megan Thee Stallion and what she said. And personally, I never asked Mr. Ed his opinion. I don't give a fuck about this person. I would know nothing about this person if it wasn't being talked about on Manosphere. So I don't know what other comments came out of there, but I'll catch up on some of the videos, because when everybody goes live at the same time or overlapping at the same time with 5-hour live streams, I can't watch all of them at the same time. I don't have that kind of time. So I have to catch up when I can. But for what I did catch up on, what I did have a chance to watch that really got me excited about stuff was this DC fandom. It was a good thing put forth, you know. Really creative innovative and a good way for the geeks to get their geek on all at the same time. I mean, you troll through YouTube and watch any geek channel, they're talking about this shit. They're breaking down every piece of it. And since I have a live show that goes on after Saturday, why the fuck not? If they can do it, I can do it too. So that's it. Thank you guys for coming through. Definitely hit the like button as you come in. Definitely support the stream. Cash App, $ Artisan MC, or PayPal, Artisan MC. And support the Patreon. I do have a Patreon. This live stream, once it's done and edited, will be up on the Patreon and not viewable on YouTube, just because I'm trying something new out. I'm trying something new. So I'm going to see how that actually works. That's the only place that you're going to be able to see this live stream once it's done. If you didn't catch it live, you fucking missed it. So it is what it is. So thank you guys for coming through, and I will see you next week. Same shop time, same shop channel. Peace. The shop is now closed.
Ain't no fucking California love. I see the niggas.
When you see Ice Cube, you better holler. Holler, holler. MC Ice Cube, you better holler and pop a collar.
Peace, y'all.